Philip, you started this mess a couple days ago, reporting on the president in meltdown mode. Of course, the Times also wrote about it. We're going to be talking to Peter in a second. Also, Vanity Fair yesterday had reports, a lot of reports coming out, basically confirming the same thing, that this president is in a very bad place, unfortunately for him and the country. And also, a lot of people in the White House feeling the walls starting to sort of move in on them.
Yeah, Joe, I think meltdown mode might be a little strong, but I'll tell you what we reported on Monday, which was when those indictments first came down in the Mueller Russia probe. The president was late getting to work. He stayed up, holed up in the residence for many hours through the morning, watching television, very concerned about these indictments, talking to his lawyers repeatedly, and he was very frustrated. He was angry with the tone of the media coverage. He felt like he had been connected to past misdeeds that Paul Manafort and Rick Gates did before they joined the Trump campaign. And was really upset by all of that. And that's the state of mind that he's been in. We know Russia has gnawed at him for many months. It's this issue that keeps coming back, and it bothers him. He sees it as an effort to illegitimize his election and his presidency.
You know, Peter Baker, the president's in a no-win situation, and I'd love for you to talk about what the Times reported. But first, before we go there, let's look at the president's logic, saying, you can't be mad at me, because Paul Manafort committed all of these federal crimes and was engaged in all of these nefarious activities before I selected him to run my campaign and tamper with the RNC's platform in Cleveland. It doesn't seem to be a very compelling argument. I can't be blamed for hiring the guy that committed all of these crimes before me.
Well, look, his point is that these crimes didn't have anything to do with the campaign, and that's true. They're about lobbying. They're about Paul Manafort's actions going back a decade in terms of his service for a pro-Russian Ukrainian political party. I think you make a good point, which is that, you know, it's correct. These are not directly related to the campaign, but he did, the president of the United States, the future president of the United States, did put in charge of his campaign somebody who we now see, according to this indictment at least, was a highly paid agent for foreign interests that were pro-Russian.
And
now,
Peter,
did that play itself out during the campaign? That's the question, is what did Paul Manafort do as campaign chairman to advance any policy goals, perhaps, of the Russians? We don't know, but he did sit in on that meeting, we know, in June 2016 with Donald Trump Jr. And the Russian lawyer. And, you know, there may be other shoes to drop. John McCain said this is a centipede. There are going to be a lot of shoes to drop.
Right. So, Peter, this cuts another way as well, obviously. If Mueller is going after the past business dealings that predated the campaign of Paul Manafort, then, as Sam Nunberg told Vanity Fair yesterday, former Trump advisor, obviously, every one of Jared Kushner's past business dealings and every one of Donald Trump's past business dealings are also now being examined, most likely, by Mueller.
Well, that could be. We don't know that Robert Mueller is giving the full forensic treatment to every business deal the president or Jared Kushner ever had. The Paul Manafort issues had been out there. They were already under investigation before Robert Mueller came onto the scene. He, in effect, inherited an ongoing investigation. So that doesn't necessarily mean or translate to the idea that everything now is up for grabs for the president and Jared Kushner, but that's certainly a concern they might have. And you heard the president say this summer when we went in to interview him in the Oval Office, he said that there is a line to be drawn as far as he was concerned, that Robert Mueller, looking into his personal or his family's personal finances outside of the context of Russia, would be a step too far, beyond a red line, he said. Now, he's calmed the rhetoric down on Mueller ever since. He's not been making threats to fire him. He's been very careful at the urging of his lawyer, Ty Cobb, and others to not directly take on Bob Mueller. But that could obviously change. He has a way of deciding to do different things at different points.
Hey, Peter, it's Willie. Can you describe for us and to our viewers the circumstances under which the President of the United States called the New York Times to talk to you and Maggie Haberman to refute the reporting of Phil Rucker?
Yeah. Well, he didn't say anything bad about Phil.
Oh, good,
I have to say that he did call because I think he's frustrated at this idea that he's sort of angry and throwing things at the wall or what have you. He didn't like the quote in the Post story that he's mad at everybody. He says, I'm not mad at anybody. Well, that may be a little much, but he wasn't in a good mood. And I think his point was, I can be annoyed or upset or concerned about these things, but it doesn't consume me, that I'm able to focus on other things. The economy is going well. I'm focused on my tax plan. I'm focused on this selection of a Fed chair. He even said, I'm looking forward to this trip to Asia, which might be a little bit of a stretch. I don't think anybody who's going on the trip is necessarily looking forward to it. It's a 12-day grind through five countries. But his point was trying to dispel this idea of a White House under siege. I think he's grown frustrated at that idea. Certainly, it's not an image that's helpful to him politically. So he wanted to reach out. He talked to my colleague Maggie Haberman and to try to dispel that point of view.
Peter, it's Heidi. What do we think of this whole effort, what looks like an effort now to discredit Papadopoulos? Because it does seem that this may be the more troubling development for the president, that Papadopoulos is cooperating. And what we've learned so far does not look good, and that he's saying that in that meeting with Trump, he said, you know, do you want to have a meeting with the Russians? And the president didn't shoot it down. That kind of flies right in the face of the president's longtime contention that he knew of no contact between his campaign and the Russians.
Yeah, no, it's obviously a concern, and it was obviously a surprise. In fact, I think there was some relief in some ways in the White House when they first saw the Manafort and Rick Gates indictment, because it was what they expected. Everybody knew this was coming. Even my 12-year-old said on Friday, who's going to be indicted? He said, well, it's going to be Manafort, right? Of course. Everybody knew it was going to be Manafort. And because the charges didn't extend to the campaign, they didn't mention President Trump's name, there was initially relief. Then the George Papadopoulos guilty plea was released, and that was a whole big, two-by-four to the head, because they hadn't seen that coming. And he's been cooperating secretly for 3 months. Imagine how that makes people feel. You look around now, you're wondering who in this room might not necessarily be on your side anymore. Is it possible somebody in this room is even wearing a wire? Those thoughts have gone through the heads of people in Mr. Trump's circle. But at the same time, they're not wrong that George Papadopoulos is not a central figure in this campaign. So when they try to belittle him and say he's just a lower-level official, there's some truth to that. The question is whether he kept people who are higher up in the chain of command in the know, and what they did with it. And what they did with this legal document is they kind of hinted at that without putting out all the evidence they have. So what we're waiting for is the next shoe, as we said, to drop, and to learn more about who George Papadopoulos engaged with in the campaign, what he was told, right, what they did inside the campaign once they had the information from him.
All right, Peter Baker, thank you so much. And Philip, let me ask you about George Papadopoulos. You're saying he wasn't a major player, and yet let's go back to the Washington Post and certainly do what Mueller's prosecution would do and say, okay, well, one of your first major editorial board meetings was at the Washington Post, and there you named him your very small group of foreign policy advisors, and that was, if I'm not mistaken, wasn't that like in June of 16? It was pretty far into the campaign. He named George Papadopoulos as, I think possibly that was his second name, as a foreign policy advisor.
Yeah, Joe, Papadopoulos was named along with a number of other advisors. And let's just put it in context for a minute here. This was a moment in the campaign where most established, seasoned Republican foreign policy experts had nothing to do with Donald Trump. They didn't want to work for this campaign. They shunned his candidacy. Jeff Sessions, then the senator from Alabama, was the top sort of policy figure on the campaign and helped put together this team of advisors. Papadopoulos was one of them. Most people in the foreign policy community had never heard of him. His credentials were pretty weak. But Trump boasted about him in that meeting with the editorial board of the Washington Post, said he's an excellent guy, and named him as a policy advisor, and then proceeded to have that meeting with him in Washington.
Wow.
So, you know, it's correct that he was not a central figure on the campaign. We never really saw him on the campaign trail. He wasn't at rallies the way Stephen Miller was, the main policy guy. But nonetheless, he was named to that team and was on the campaign.
All right. Thank you so much, Washington Post. Philip Rucker, we greatly appreciate it. So, Sam, again, let's look. They have a pattern. The president especially has a pattern. Paul Manafort. Mm-hmm. They actually, oh, well, you know what? He wasn't really. He was just here for a minute or two. Donald Trump and Jared Kushner and everybody else involved in that campaign told everybody in the media, this guy is going to help us get the number that we need to get over the top. I mean, that's all they talked about in the summer of 2016, that they had to get rid of Corey Lewandowski because Corey didn't know how to get delegates or count delegates. They were bringing in the pro. The pro was Paul Manafort, and he was critical to get Donald Trump over the top.
Sure.
And now they're saying nothing to see here. Same thing again with George Papadopoulos, saying he was a critical part of his foreign policy team in 2016, when all of this activity was taking place, by the way. It's not taking place now.
So we need to unpack a few things. One is, so I was wondering the same thing too, and we looked at the Daily Beast, looked into this guy, George Papadopoulos, to see just how critical a role he actually played in the campaign. I called high school classmates, college professors, campaign pros, people who were in Republican circles, people who worked on the Ben Carson campaign, Donald Trump campaign. The truth of the matter is this. He is almost universally unmemorable. No one knows this guy. He came literally out of nowhere. His own college professors say that he wasn't a very bright student. They were shocked that he ended up on Donald Trump's
campaign. How did he get on the campaign?
So this is the great unknown. He ends up in D.C. after going to DePaul University, works at the Hudson Institute, is sort of a self-promoter, opportunistic, manages to find his way onto Ben Carson's campaign.
Right.
That's the great mystery, is how did Ben Carson's campaign pluck this guy out of the air? How he got onto Trump's campaign is better known. Sam Clovis, as we know, Iowa guy, politician, was asked to put together a list of foreign policy officials that Donald Trump could say were advising him because Donald Trump was getting all these questions about why he didn't have a foreign policy team. Sam Clovis puts together this.
Right.
On the list are two names that now are quite troublesome for Trump.
Carter Page,
George Papadopoulos. Trump sits down with the Post editorial board, as is his want. He overemphasizes their credentials, calls Papadopoulos a very well-regarded oil and gas guy. No one's quite sure why. But in that moment, he attaches himself to Papadopoulos. This is not to say that Papadopoulos is a minor player.
Is he an oil and gas guy?
No one knows. No one actually knows.
So
he was a vocally pro-fracking operative.
If he were, you would know. Right?
Correct.
I mean, he would have some history of employment.
This is critical. This is critical. Just because Papadopoulos isn't a well-known entity doesn't mean he's not an important entity. On the Trump campaign, it is clear he was sending emails where he was saying, we have Russian officials that want to meet with you. Just because Papadopoulos came from nowhere doesn't mean that those emails are irrelevant or not important.
By the
way, quite important.
Yeah, where was John Dean? I mean, where did John Dean come from? I mean, I'm sure he has. What I'm saying is somebody that you don't know before
doesn't
something
mean
blows up
important.
Doesn't mean they don't become a key player.
And I think the bigger picture is that
and
this
I'm
gets
sure
to.
I haven't seen. I'm sure John Dean like went to Oxford and then Harvard.
Well, Papadopoulos says he went to the London University School of Economics. We couldn't figure if
everybody
that was true.
Says that.
Anyways, the point in the end is the point in the end is Trump has this problem, which is while he is a non-establishment candidate and that helps him, it hurts him because he doesn't have actual people who are good at their jobs surrounding him, and he relies on people like Papadopoulos who then freelance with Russian officials.
His family works for him. There you go.
Thanks for checking out MSNBC on YouTube, and make sure you subscribe to stay up to date on the day's biggest stories, and you can click on any of the videos around us to watch more from Morning Joe and MSNBC. Thanks so much for watching.